Oh, why does this one divide again?
Yeah, because it's already happened.
Okay. I don't think I go over it here. To understand that, you have to understand that prophase one, metaphase one, anaphase one. Okay. So, in mitosis, if I'm going to divide, okay, and I'm going to have my daughter cells having the same number, I got to make a copy. Don't I? If I have 46 chromosomes here, and I'm going to divide into two, and both these cells are going to have 46 chromosomes somewhere, I got to make a copy. Does that make sense?
DNA replication.
You're not sure?
Not sure.
Like, well,
when it was a divide, it's making two copies. Look.
Here's a cell. It's got 46 chromosomes. That's going to divide into two. Okay, those 46 come down here. Where does this one get? That's 46. Yeah, makes a copy. Mama makes a copy. And since 146 over here and one of the 46 over here. Okay? So, in meiosis, the same thing happens. Okay? The difference is that I've got 46 here, and when I make my copy, I hook them up. They're attached. They're holding hands. So that when I divide this way, okay, well,
that makes sense. It makes sense.
When I do it that way, I've got 23 here and 23 here, but these 23 are holding hands. You see? And now when I come down here, I stop holding hands, if that makes sense. Second division is because you duplicated the chromosomes. And so you got to spread them out.
So even though it's one N?
Even though this is one N here, it's got enough DNA for two cells.
It still has 46, but it's not 46. Of the same.
It's got 23.
Either from mom or dad, but 23.
Yep. But it's duplicated.
It's all coming back.
Yeah,
it's just faded memory.
Why we have to repeat some of this stuff. But that's why.
Yeah,
because you made a copy and therefore you got to spread them out. Yeah.
So just to be clear, this spermatozoa, that's really just a picture?
Yeah, when you finish. See, right here, they're round. We got to get rid of all that cytoplasm and get into the tail and all that kind of stuff. But we're not dividing anymore.
I was just wondering, I think you answered my question, but
that
23 did divide
in half. Yeah, here's no division, it's just maturation.
No, from secondary to the sperm.
Okay, what about?
Chromosomes don't divide.
No, that happened way up here. Happened way up there. Two chromosomes, okay? Got one that looks like this and one that looks like this. Now we're going to go through mitosis, okay? And this guy makes a copy and this guy makes a copy. Now when they divide, we're going to end up like this. Now I have two chromosomes here, right? Now I make a copy of each one of those. And when I separate, this one goes here, and let's make it squiggly so we can see it, okay? So this started off with two, and each of the daughters had two, right? follow that?
Okay. Now, let's come over here. Okay, we're going to make a copy. Okay, now. I'm pausing and thinking about the way I should have done this over here differently. If we've got two sets here, okay, let me just change this a little bit. How many of those chromosomes do we have? Let's say it's chromosome number one. How many would we have? In a normal cell?
40.
Who's talking?
Is it 46?
What?
46.
No, not the total number. That one V-shaped chromosome. How many of those V-shaped chromosomes do I have?
One. Two.
Two. One from mommy, one from daddy. Okay? So I got two.
Diploid.
Okay, how many of the straight chromosomes do I have?
Two.
Okay, now we're getting ready to divide by mitosis. So this guy makes a copy, this one makes a copy, this one makes a copy, this one makes a copy. Now we're going to split those up, okay? Now we're going to end up with something like this. Okay? I don't know, I got all these squiggles right here. So, I started off with four, and I end up with four and four, right? Because I started with four, and I made four, and so I split them up. Okay, now, so I'm over here, and I've got four, and I make a copy. Okay? But one of the things that happens in that prophase, metaphase, all that kind of stuff, is similar chromosomes come together. So this guy's going to come up here, and they're going to latch onto each other. It's called synapsing. Okay? You follow that? Similar chromosomes find each other and stick together. Now, in the reductional division, we're going to get reduce. You see, if the two chromosomes are stuck together, they are considered one chromosome. It's a little bit like this. You got a pregnant woman. She's in the delivery room. Census taker walks in, counting all the people in the United States. And he goes, let's see, one doctor, one nurse, one pregnant lady, three walks out. Now, if he walked in 5 minutes later, he'd go, one doctor, one nurse, one mama, one baby, four. So as long as that baby is in you, census-wise, it is one person. When the baby comes out, you now have two. So it's the same thing here. If these guys are attached, it's considered one. So they come down here like this, okay, and it's considered reductional because there are two. Even though there's enough DNA there for another cell. So then you go through another division, right? And that's why we need that second division, is to break that apart.
Is that helping him? I get paid extra for this?
I should get paid extra for this. Yeah. Are you quizzing me?
Just trying to find out what I know?
Well, as long as you know what you're doing. Okay. Now, where are we at? Okay, sperm anatomy. Okay, so we looked at sperm anatomy. We can divide it into a head. The head will have a cap on it known as an acrosome. It's carrying lots of enzymes to help it break through to the egg. Okay. The acrosome carries an enzyme called hyaluronidase. The cement that holds two cells together is hyaluronic acid. So a nice way to break through is to turn that cement into mush. And that's what hyaluronidase does. It's like if we were locked into this room and this was a brick room, it would be hard to get out. But if we had something to make the cement gooey, then we could push through easy. You know what I'm saying? And so this stuff makes the cement between the cells gooey. Okay? There's proteases there. Nucleus is in here. That's the major part. Okay? Midpiece here. Okay? With a neck. Midpiece goes from here to here. It has a neck that contains centrioles. Everybody familiar with centrioles? Okay? And the body right there, which contains mitochondria for energy production. And then we have the tail with flagella. Not spelled right, but it's still flagella. Okay?
Now, 50% of the population, of the human population, has flagella. The other 50% doesn't. What 50% has flagella?
Males.
Males. Yeah. Males are the only ones that, well, they transfer the flagella, but the only ones that make it. Right? Not all animals are that way. There's a group of animals called flagellates. You know? Yeah. That are identified by the flagella.
Okay.
Now, this head, in humans or in animals, the head of the sperm is pretty constant. In other words, if you looked at the head of a sperm of somebody from Africa versus Europe versus Asia or whatever, it would be the same. But if we look at it across animals, it can be very different. And so one of my students is looking at gametes, not just sperm, but eggs as well, morphology, structure of sea urchins. And we found one on Saipan where the head is drawn out, it really almost looks like a flagellum, just drawn out really long, you know? And so people who spend a lot of time studying this can often identify what animal something came from by the morphology. So it can be very different. What animal do you think makes the biggest sperm cell in the world that we know of?
Whales.
Huh?
Whales.
People are talking.
Whale.
Quite good guess. No, but a good guess. I mean, that's a reasonable guess. What else?
Plants.
What?
Plants. Plants.
Plants?
Yeah.
Well, I said animals, but you got the wrong group there. But frogs? No? Can I tell you? It's a fruit fly.
Why?
One species of fruit fly that lives here in Hawaii makes the biggest sperm cell of any animal we know of today. Now, tomorrow we may discover a bigger one someplace. But as of right now, it's a fruit fly. You would have thought whale, elephant, hippopotamus, rhinoceros, or something. No, just a little dinky fruit fly that comes around when you leave your apple out too long or something. Yeah. And it's only one species. Okay, now we're going to go into the female system, okay? And we're going to start with ovogenesis. Whereas with the male, I started with anatomy, okay? With the female, we're going to start with oogenesis because I want to compare it to male spermatogenesis, okay? And so that's why I want to do it right afterwards and we get finished with that and we go into female anatomy. But female oogenesis, if you thought male was complex, female, this is really complex, okay? So I don't want to start it now because it's really difficult. So we'll pick it up on Monday.